When I was a small channel, I made two videos, one on Rank 10 Yu-Gi-Oh! And one on Team Samurai X1, where I hypothesize how they got such a large following. Now, I'm a much larger channel than I was back then, but I wanted to do today's video, which is talking about why SEMO just hit 100k subscribers, and while I could kind of theorize why it happened, I thought there'd be no better option than to just ask SEMO to come on my channel, and I'm going to ask him a few questions related to his monumental success, because if you guys don't know, it's really hard to hit 100k subs in our community. There's only now 6 channels that have made that mark, and that is not very much in relation to how many channels there are out there that are talking about Yu-Gi-Oh! So anyway, in today's video, we're going to ask SEMO some questions, and we're going to congratulate him on reaching 100k subscribers. So how are you doing, SEMO? What does it feel like to be a channel with 100k subs?
Feels like we don't have as many O's in 100,000 as we do in my name, so we got a ways to go, but no, it feels really good.
Oh man, yeah, I didn't even think of that. Okay, do you think that it is like really cool to be the 6th YouTuber? Do you like the direction that there's more 100k channel subs in the Yu-Gi-Oh community happening? I mean, back in the day, for the longest time, it was just simply Unlucky and Cyber Knight, and now we have a couple more channels that are sort of creeping up on the 100k. You're sort of the first person of that new wave Yugi tubing to actually get there, though.
Yeah, I mean, I think it definitely shows that the game is by no means dead. I think it shows that, you know, if a channel can still hit 100,000 subs, especially in the time frame, because I feel like compared to some of the other channels, I might have done it quicker. I'm not 100% sure on that, though. But I mean, I would kind of group Team Sam and myself kind of in a little bit in the same category because we have similar styles. We do some things differently, obviously, but even though he definitely started before I did, I'd say like stylistically, because the pack opening channels hit 100,000, you know, first, and then Galactic God and like Sam were like then the next ones, but Galactic God's obviously retired. So, but I mean, he had his own style altogether, but I think it definitely genuinely shows that there's still interest in the game, and I think that's a good thing.
Yeah, so when did you realize that your channel had the potential to be this huge thing? I mean, obviously, I know like a year ago, you sort of put school to the side. It was not your undergrad degree, it was your graduate degree.
Yeah.
And you kind of put that aside to focus on YouTubing. I'm assuming it might have been a little bit before that you realized that YouTube, your YouTube in particular, had the chance to just be this gigantic thing later on. When was the moment, if there was a moment, that you realized the potential that you had?
So it's a funny story, because I quit my job that I started right out of college. I was working for a solar company managing lots of different accounts, and I quit just because it was way overbearing. The company was basically putting too much of the weight of the company like on myself as well as a few other individuals, and so I pretty much like hit my breaking point and just literally rage quit. I literally walked in, put my stuff on the counter, and walked out. In pretty dramatic SEMO fashion, I guess. But so the interesting thing was, I'm like, all right, well, what am I going to do now? Because at that time, I was still doing this as more of a hobby than actually, you know, a full-time thing. But I'm like, well, now I can actually dedicate the time and do that. But I didn't exactly know how that was going to play out. So I'm like, well, you know, I think it might be a good idea just to go back to school, because my school really wanted me to enter their graduate program. They were like grooming me since sophomore and junior year to enter the graduate program. So I basically messaged them and they're like, oh yeah, sure. And it wouldn't start until like the following year though. And I quit my job kind of, I would say like 8 months before I was actually going to start. So that time goes by. I pretty much up the consistency of my uploads, because now I have all this extra free time to be able to do that. And then came the time where, oh, school's going to be starting soon. And this is where I'm kind of at that point where I'm starting to really, really snowball, and I'm gaining a lot of subs, a lot of traction, a lot of views. And I'm like, wow, you know, if I go to grad school, you know, I might not have the time to dedicate to be able to do this. I mean, I could probably manage it, but probably not to the best of my ability. So
yeah,
I actually,
almost certainly not daily uploads or anything like that.
Right, exactly. So I actually made the painstaking decision, at least at the time, that I was going to do this over grad school. And I say painstaking because I had to tell like my family that that's what the plan was. And I felt like weird doing that, because it's like, yeah, this was the plan for like, you know, 8 months a year. Oh, hey, guess what? I'm not going to do that anymore. So it was a bit weird, but they were completely supportive, which they always have been, so I wasn't really too surprised. But it was just kind of those feelings of angst about doing that. And then basically I'm like, okay, I'm going to give myself 1 year, which I think we're actually coming up on that year about now. And if it takes off, then this is what I'm meant to do. And if not, I can defer my enrollment for a year and I can just start up again. Sure enough, I hit 100,000 subscribers not too long ago, and I'm pretty much, I just emailed my school. I'm like, yeah, I'm not coming back.
Right. Yeah, I think that that's really interesting that you touched on that, because for a lot of you guys out there, you might not know. I mean, you might look at the smaller channels and be like, okay, they're doing this part-time. Then you might look at like us and say, okay, they're doing it full-time. But pretty much all of us had at least a 1 or 2 month period where we were kind of in that transition area where we were like, okay, we're almost at like the full-time income, but not quite. So you're like, I know for me, that was like October of last year where I was like, or I guess September of last year where I was like, okay, I'm almost to the point where I can quit my day job to do this, so like I'm focusing way more on YouTube, but obviously like you said, it can all just crash and burn. So like your plan of giving yourself a 1 year time frame, why do you think you made it to 100k subs in that time frame? I mean, for those of you that don't know, SEMO was one of the fastest growing channels of 2017, which is extremely impressive. A lot of really new channels sort of popped up in 2017 to make those really big marks. You were one of them, if not the biggest one. I don't actually know the numbers on if you or Sam grew more last year, but you both are like obviously crazy growth that in 2017. Why do you think you were the one channel at least to do this, to get to that 100k from only starting at, I mean, how many subs were you at like at the start of 2017? Not that many. I mean, a lot, but not like a crazy amount, right?
No, at the start of 17. So I don't know if at the start, but I do know at Valentine's Day last year, I was at 25,000 because I did a 25,000 sub like Valentine's Day special. So I know February last year, I had 25,000. So just to give, you know, some reference. And you know, it's a good question because I sometimes ask myself the same thing. I'm like, why is it me? And I've asked some people, you know, I've asked, you know, you guys, but I've also asked like fans at the same time when I'm at events. And it's kind of a weird thing. It's like, I guess it's like, what do you like so much about my content, or like what keeps you coming back? Kind of to see what people's thoughts are as a general, you know, general consensus. And a lot of people say it's one, because I show myself in like every video, because I guess I just create this interpersonal connection through the camera. And it seems weird to me because I guess I didn't necessarily think of it that way, but I think that was kind of new for when I was rising up, because most channels, you know, kind of, you know, just do a screen cap or just don't really show themselves too often. Yeah, and, which
like
is
you see
fine,
the hands of the pack opener, you see like the, you don't see anything with like a lot of the replay channels. A lot of you guys that are watching, especially if you're new to the YouTubing scene, just to briefly clarify what SEMO's saying here, a lot of the old school YouTube channels didn't really show their face. They were always the person behind the camera. And it might seem kind of commonplace nowadays to have people sit down with a webcam, sit down with their phone and record themselves and talk about Yu-Gi-Oh! But when SEMO was first growing, that really wasn't the norm at all. It was actually kind of an anomaly.
Yeah, it really was. And so now you see people, like even the pack openers have face cams now, and a lot of the older tubers, like the granddaddies, like M-Cole and stuff, like they have face cams. But I think I was like one of like the first to really pioneer it on such a consistent level. But then the other thing is, really, a lot of people tell me that I can take like competitive Yu-Gi-Oh specifically, or I can take seemingly complex ideas and actually break them down simplistically enough that realistically anyone can understand at any skill level. And funny enough, I was actually going to go to grad school to become a teacher. So, I mean, I guess that's kind of like the same thing.
That's like
so I
a
ended
teacher
up being
skill,
a teacher
yeah.
anyway.
Yeah, the teacher of Yu-Gi-Oh. Just to ask you, I guess these two questions kind of go together. What was one video that you were surprised ended up being like really big? And then also a video that you thought was going to be really big and then kind of flopped?
Ooh, that's a tough one. Give me a second. Let me actually go look.
Okay. Yeah, while you're looking that up, I guess I can ask you the next question. While you were a smaller channel, what do you feel was like a really good decision that you made? I guess that could be the face cam. And then what do you feel like a really bad decision that looking back on it, you're like, why did I think that was a good idea?
Okay. Good decision, I think, was the consistent uploads, because I didn't start really consistently uploading until I would say when I quit my job. That's when I really was starting going daily with, not daily, but like pretty much 5 days, 4 to 5 days a week. So pretty much just skipping weekends. And I feel like that was one of the biggest things that was really holding me back at first, because I wanted to make more content, but it was not something that I could do just because of my time. But once I quit, I'm like, all right, well, I got all the time now. And I feel like when I started doing it, that's when I really started the growth start to like exponentially rise. And even on the charts, like I would notice that too. And I guess it makes sense. If you make more content, more people are going to see it. So it's going to result in more views, more subscribers, things like that. So consistency is like the number one thing. And people always ask like what you should do. I think that's probably one of the biggest things, is like you got to be consistent. As for something that didn't necessarily work out, I don't know. I've had some like really stupid like video ideas before, and they just like really never like panned out. And the thing is, it might not necessarily panned out because of the video itself, but maybe because of the execution of it, or maybe the delivery, or maybe how,
or even the timing of when it was uploaded.
Exactly,
affected a lot.
Right, because the thing is, when you're a larger channel and you try something new, it's might not get as much traction as something people might be used to, but it's way different than when you try something new when you're a smaller channel, because that, like, proportionally, still a lot of people are going to see something new that you try out when you're larger. Whereas when you're smaller, you have to take the, you know, the minute number of views you're getting at that point and slash it even lower. So, right. You know, it's kind of this interesting dynamic. But so now it's like, it's weird, because now that I have a lot more views, I'm more inclined to try a lot more like different things that I wasn't, you know, comfortable doing before, because now I feel like they might have more potential to take off now that I have the base kind of already established, if that makes sense.
No, that, yeah, actually, like, I find that exact same thing. It might seem like you can take less risks when you get bigger, because you're like, oh, I don't want to lose my audience, but actually what ends up happening is exactly what you described, where because you're a bigger channel, the videos that you make that maybe are more risky, not only do they, if they flop, you're going to get way more views than if you were a smaller channel, but the really cool thing that can happen, and that has probably happened to you, and it's definitely happened to me a couple times, is that sometimes those risky videos actually pay off because you're a bigger channel, and end up just growing exponentially, like way greater than you ever thought they would have been able to.
Yeah.
And I think that's something that, as a bigger channel, is sort of like a bigger channel privilege, really, is when you make those sort of, because some people are going to watch it, and by some, I mean, like, probably thousands. I mean, I think of that dumb Hearthstone video that I posted, like, last week. That video got, like, 7,000 to 8,000 views, and it didn't even have, like, a real title. Okay, so to go back to the video questions on which one ended up being bigger than you thought, which one ended up being smaller than you thought, it seems like you came up with an answer, right?
Yeah, so I did not expect the video I did with my grandpa to be nearly as popular as it ended up being.
Really?
Like, some people say, like, oh, well, it's kind of like, you know, it's your grandpa, and it's like old people, and it's cute and adorable. And I get that, but it's, I don't know. I guess it's because I've known my grandpa for so long, and that's something I'm just used to. I just wanted to do it for fun, and I had zero expectation of how well it was going to do. So I was kind of looking at it through a different lens, and then it just, like, blew, like, up.
That's your biggest video, right?
Yeah, it's my biggest. It's over 500,000 views now, which is insane.
It's crazy.
And it's adorable, because my grandpa calls me on a weekly basis asking how many views it's at. So that's pretty funny.
Got to give him a cut of that check.
Yeah, I told him I'd fly him out so we can do another one, because he really he apparently has an eye on the spotlight now that he knows he's famous.
Oh my gosh. And then, yeah, for the video that you thought was gonna be like really big, but then ended up not being big.
Yeah, I mean, I've had a couple. I think it's just more general discussions. Like, I don't think there's any one in particular that I can, like, pinpoint. But, you know, just when you're talking about things that might not necessarily tie into, like, whole-on Yu-Gi-Oh!, but it's, like, more so, like, these existential kind of videos that are talking more about applying, you know, the concepts of Yu-Gi-Oh! To, like, different aspects of your life and things like that. I've tried some videos like that in the past. They never really took off. I'm trying to, like, breathe some new life into it by having it come from like a pro player perspective. So, I mean, we'll see if that takes off. I just launched that not too long ago. But yeah, I mean, I've had my fair share of things that, you know, I thought, hey, this will be a good idea, and then they just never took off.
Yeah. Next question and second to last one. How do you feel about the direction that Yugi tubing is going? Longtime followers of my channel might know that it's not really like a direct chronological like ordering of like what topics are popular in Yugi tubing, but it kind of did go. I mean, back in the day, almost all the videos were just and this sounds crazy if you weren't watching like way back in the day, but almost all the videos uploaded in the first couple of years of Yugi tubing were just pro player deck profiles and top deck profiles and top matches and stuff. Mm-hmm. After that, it kind of went to pack openers and then replay channels, like the Dueling Network replay channels, and then now it kind of is in like the discussion area, but it's not like only discussion videos are at the top. But how do you feel about the direction of Yugi tubing, and do you think discussion videos will be big for the foreseeable future? Do you think one of those other sort of genres could come back into the limelight?
I think it's definitely improved drastically since you know, just even not too long ago. I think because as a community, even though we might not all interact with one another, we're kind of pushing each other to like kind of set that new standard, kind of like how we were alluding to before with, you know, showing, you know, the face, including the face cam, but not even that, like having full on like professional recording equipment. So it's not even just webcam quality, it's like 1080p 60 fps 4k quality, basically just trying to make it as good as possible. Now that's not necessary to make good content. I don't want to like people to assume that that's what you need to do to be successful. It's not. That's just a decision I personally wanted to make for how I do things. But I think when you extrapolate that concept and kind of push it to the content itself, even though we are like competing against each other in a way when it comes to content, it's also kind of like, oh, that person came up with a really good idea. What's something that I could come up with that's, you know, not directly copying them, but something that's, you know, something that I can, you know, do that puts my own spin on something. You know, people say that they watch, like, banlist videos are the best example of this, because why do people watch every single banlist reaction video when the banlist comes out? A, they're excited. B, they want to see their favorite personalities talk about the list, and they all have different things to say about it. And that's what the, you know, what's so glorious about this is that, again, even though I guess we're competing again, we're realistically, there's enough views for everyone because one person can watch 10 of us and that's okay. So there's enough room, especially now, there's plenty of other tubers that could still rise up. Nothing's stopping it. And if someone wants to go just way out there and just do things that we haven't even done before, I wholeheartedly welcome it. But I think it's definitely going in a good direction. I think we're, you know, kind of redefining what Yugi tubing content really is. And I think, you know, that's a positive thing for the foreseeable future.
The final question is quite simply, now that you have 100,000 subscribers, what can the community expect from your channel? What should they look forward to on the SEMO channel in their subscription feed?
I've been asking myself the same thing a lot recently, because I feel like now that I've hit this benchmark, I kind of have to push even harder. Not for, you know, views or subs or anything, but more because I want to push that envelope again of, you know, redefining how good the content is that we can actually create. I want to go back and like redo the whole how to play Yu-Gi-Oh thing for new players, because I still feel like there's a huge barrier to entry with this game, especially with links and all this other stuff, or even returning players. Like returning players will send me messages all the time saying, you know, thank you, because I don't understand any of this, but then I saw your videos and now it makes perfect sense. So there's a lot there that I feel like I want to go back to and touch on. And even though that's not going to appeal to my mass audience, I think for the greater good, or maybe if you want to show a friend how to play the game, I think that'd be very beneficial. And I did that back when I had like 10,000 subs, maybe. So I've improved a lot since then. So I feel like I could do a much better job with it. But moving on to like the typical stuff, I'm going to keep bringing the competitive content, because I feel like that is my niche when it comes to Yugi tubing, you know, the meta analysis, you know, stuff like that. But I also kind of want to just take it a step further, like kind of going above and beyond, maybe kind of doing like live match analysis, like turn by turn, trying to figure out like the best way to make the best move, or, you know, all these things that people really haven't tried before that would require a much more equipment and a lot more people to kind of work on. We'll see though. I'm going to keep pumping out the competitive content, because that's bread and butter of my channel. So
Okay, makes sense. Well, thank you so much for coming on. Congratulations on 100K subs. And I'm sure all of you are subscribed to him, but I'll make sure to put Simo's channel link in the description just in case you've never heard of him before today and you're like, oh, who's that guy? He's gonna replace as many subs as me. But thank you so much for coming on.